My name is Lale Coram Del Ameri. Actually, I am from Vienna, so I am Viennese and Austrian. But since 2.5 years, I'm working for the Educational Testing Service in the United States, together with Matthias von der Veer, who is my manager. And together with him, I did a lot of research on the work that I'm going to present today. And it's about new IRT approaches to measure and correct for response styles in international large-scale assessments. When we try to measure non-cognitive constructs with rating scales or Likert type scales. I will give you an overview of the problems of response style and Likert type scales, of the definition of response styles, why it is a problem in large-scale assessments, why it can bias our data and harm the validity of the measurement. Then I will give you an overview of the approach that we are pursuing and first results of our studies that we did so far. When we want to measure non-cognitive constructs, such as aspects of personality or different attitudes, we are very often using rating scales or so-called Likert type scales, which are a type of rating scales. They are very popular in this area. And typically, rating scales consist of at least four different response options, which are usually ordered. And here, is an example of such a rating scale. You can see normally when you respond to a questionnaire or a non-cognitive construct questionnaire, you get statements or questions, and then you have to respond on such a response format. In this example, we can decide between very accurate to very accurate. You could also have other terms like I totally agree to I totally disagree. Or you can just have numbers instead of verbal terms. Or you can just have some, you know, pictures like smiley. So there are different kind of rating scales you can use. This is just one. And sometimes a middle category is added to these rating scales that should reflect a neutral or undecided response, like here with the term neither nor, or it should reflect an average degree of the characteristic that is to be measured. Rating scales are not without problems, so there are a lot of issues we have to deal with when we use this kind of response format. And one issue and one problem are so-called response styles that can happen when we use these rating scales. Response styles are defined as respondents or test takers' tendencies to respond in a systematic way independent of the item content. So they are giving construct irrelevant responses. So invalid random responses that actually are not really an expression of what is to be measured. Response styles are assumed to be largely stable individual characteristics, and they were shown to be stable across different assessments and over time. Depending on of the number of response categories offered in a rating scale, different kind of response styles might occur. And in our studies, we mainly focus on the extreme response style and the midpoint response style. So there are different kind of response style, but the studies I'm presenting are mainly focused on these two. It was shown in different studies that there are cultural and also gender differences in the tendencies of giving response styles. So response styles might be responsible for cultural and other group differences that were found in studies that did not account for response styles or their bias. And therefore, response styles are especially a problem in international large-scale assessments that aim to compare respondents from different countries. Response styles can influence the dimensionality of the measurement, cause bias to survey results, and harm the validity of the measurement. There can be different reasons for response styles or why response styles occur in the data. One reason might be that the test taker has a low acceptance for the test or the assessment that is applied. Another reason can be that the respondent has a low test-taking motivation. Those two issues often occur in so-called low-stakes assessments. Low-stakes assessments are assessments where the test results have no consequences for the test takers. Large-scale assessments are often more slow-stakes assessments, because students don't really gain everything. Like students in PISA, they don't have everything from participating in the study. They don't get feedback, they don't get anything from it. So they might not be that highly motivated. Other reasons might be that the test taker does not really understand the question or the questions that are asked, either due to ability or proficiency, for example, a low reading ability, or due to just bad questions or items, where we have, for example, inconsistent or too complex and complicated texts. Another reason for response styles might be fatigue effects towards a long assessment. So it could be that, for example, a respondent is motivated to do the assessment or respond to a questionnaire, but it's a very long assessment, and towards the end, the respondent gets tired or a little bit less motivated, and then at the end, response styles might occur. So in this example, we would expect that there are a couple of responders from the respondent that are valid responses, and that would reflect the construct we want to measure. But then there are also responses that are more due to response styles and that are random invalid responses. This would stay in contrast to test takers who, from the beginning or in general, show a very low test-taking motivation. From these kind of respondents, we would expect that they give invalid responses and response styles throughout the assessment. So there are different extents to which response styles can be given by different test takers. This is an example I would like to show you to state in which way response styles could harm or influence the dimensionality of the measurement. Let's assume we have a 5-point rating scale or Likert scale like here. And let's assume we have 8 items that are supposed to measure the dimension extroversion. One respondent, respondent A in our case, could give only extreme responses, so either 0 or 4 in our case. And respondent B could only give responses towards the midpoint of the scale. Both respondents show the same score, which would be 16. So the same level of extroversion would be assumed for both respondents just based on this raw score. But the question is, do we really measure the same with these two scores? That is, do we measure an average level of extroversion, or in this example, just two different kind of response styles, an extreme response style and a midpoint response style. There are different approaches to measure and account for response style in item response theory. One of the most recent IRT approaches to measure response style comes from Ulf Böckenholt. And he, based on multinomial processing trees, I will show you one on the next slide to give an example, decomposes the responses, the observed responses to a rating scale into different single multiple nested response subprocesses, and he calls them pseudo-items. Then the pseudo-items or subprocesses are modeled with IRT models and can be related to other covariates that are of interest, for example, personality traits, gender, age, or culture, to get more information about the kind of response styles that we are looking at. So to give you a better idea how this decomposition could work, so let's imagine we have a 5-point rating scale, which is kind of convenient because all of the studies that I'm going to present on the next slide are based on 5-point rating scales. So let's assume we have this 5-point rating scale, and usually when a respondent responds to this scale, depending on the response options the respondent would choose, we would give one of these numbers as a score. So if the respondent would choose the first option, we would give a 0 as a score. If he would choose the third option, we would give a 2, and so on. So usually we would score the responses like this. And now imagine that we want to know how does a person get to the response. What does happen before that? So this tree that you see here shows a possible response tree or response process. The first process could be that the respondent decides to either respond to the midpoint of the scale or to make a clear cut decision towards the left or the right side of the scale. In the second case, there could be a second response process where the respondent either agrees or disagrees, and then there might be a third process where the respondent chooses to either give an extreme or a non-extreme agreement or disagreement. It doesn't have to be in this order. It could actually be another order. It could be that the respondent first decides to agree, but then cannot decide between a non-extreme or an extreme agreement, and then goes back and gives a midpoint response. So this response tree is just one possible order that we can look at. When we look at these different response processes, this gives the idea that we could code those different response processes in a different way. For example, if we are interested in the midpoint of the scale because we want to measure a midpoint response style, we could use this subprocess and look at all the midpoint responses a respondent gives and code it with a 1. And all the other responses this respondent would give, we can code as a 0. We can do the same when we are interested only in the extreme responders. So every time a respondent would give a negative or a positive extreme response, we can code it as a 1 and 0 or missing value otherwise. In this way, we have two binary pseudo items and both account for different subprocesses, the process where I would choose the midpoint of the scale and the process where I would choose an extreme positive or negative response. Now we can use these so-called binary pseudo-items or binary scores to check if we have a midpoint or an extreme response style present in our data. The idea is when we do have a midpoint response style in the data or when we do have an extreme response style in the data, then those two items or the scores based on these items should be a measurement of this kind of response styles. And if we do have response style in the data, then we should use a score that is hardly or very little influenced by this kind of response styles and based only on response categories that are not biased by response style. In our case, we tried this kind of score where we accounted, we called it the D items, and we account only for moderate and extreme responses towards the trait that is measured. You could use different kind of scorings, of course, so the scorings we used here in the binary pseudo items, that's just an assumption that we make, that are just hypotheses. You can have different hypotheses about the response process or about the response styles, but the nice thing is here, or the beauty of this approach is that by decomposing it into the different kind of hypotheses or pseudo items, you can actually test it with RLT if your assumptions are good assumptions. If they make sense or if this course do not make sense. While Böckenholt used this approach and tested it out on a questionnaire with just a single scale, Matthias and I extended his approach to questionnaires with multiple scales, so where we don't have only one scale but 4 or 5 different scales, and we applied it to personality data, where we measured the big 5 personality constructs, and we applied it to large-scale assessment data, to PISA and PIAAC, where we measured personality constructs and other self-ratings. So what is the difference between the approaches? When you look at the Böckenholt approach, let's imagine we have just one questionnaire scale that we're interested in. It may be extroversion, it may be openness to experience, it may be something else. And let's assume in this one scale we don't have any response styles. Then we would choose this one-dimensional model and the scoring in this one-dimensional model, so we would have our E items, our M items, and our D items, so the pseudo items that we decomposed our responses into, and all the items would load on one factor. Here we see they all load on the first factor, you see it by the ones here. So if we don't have response style, then this model, this RLT model, a one-dimensional model, would fit the data, our pseudo-item data. If we do have response styles, that would be the other model and the other hypothesis, then the E, M, and D items, they would load on 3 different factors, and we would have a 3-dimensional model. And now, when we have these loadings in the models, these factor loadings, we can compare them in an RLT model. So we can compare these 3 with the one-dimensional model and look which model fits the data better. And if we see that the one-dimensional model fits the data better than the 3-dimensional model, then this would support the fact that we probably don't see any response styles in the data and that E and M items are just valid measures and valid responses that we see. So in this case, we could probably just stay with the original scores just using the five responses from the five-point rating scale without going to the pseudo-items. If, however, the three-dimensional model fits the data relatively better than the one-dimensional model, then this might support the hypothesis that we do have response styles, a midpoint and an extreme response styles. And in this case, the D-item score might be a better measurement of the scale that we want to measure than the original Likert type scale. When we now go to the multidimensional extension, where we have not only one scale, but multiple scales, let's say we have a big five questionnaire with five different scales, then we have the opportunity to only look at one of these pseudo-items at a time. So we don't have to put all the pseudo-items into a model to check if there are responses or not. We can, for example, only concentrate on the extreme response style alone and just look at the E items. And here you would say, if we don't have response style, then the E items should be valid measures for the five dimensions that we want to measure. So we would have the left factor loading matrix. But if the E items are a measure of an extreme response style, then we would have the measure, then we would have the factor loading matrix on the right side, where all the E items are loading on one factor. And then we can compare this one-dimensional model to the five-dimensional model, and if the one-dimensional model fits the data relatively best, then we can assume that we have a kind of extreme response style in the data. And if the five-dimensional model fits the data relatively best, then we can assume that we don't have an extreme response style. And then we can do the same for the M items to see if we have a midpoint response style, and then we can do the same for the D items to see if the D items are really measuring this five construct or just another factor that we don't want to measure. So this is what we can do. Of course, when we have five different questionnaire scales, we also can do the Birkenholz approach, where we have multiple response style factor, but instead of a one versus a three-dimensional model, we would then have a five-dimensional versus a seven-dimensional model. In the five-dimensional model, we would just have our five questionnaire scales as factors. In the seven-dimensional model, we would add additional ERS and MRS factors, so response style factors. And the matrix we would put into our IoT model would look like this. So this is how the approach looks so far. So we decompose our five-point rating scale into those binary pseudo-items or response processes, and then we test in the IoT models by comparing unidimensional to multidimensional IoT models which score fits the data relatively best and which hypotheses we can assume and which we have to let go. The main idea is if we have content-independent response styles in the data, then we should be able to find unidimensional measurements of response styles across the multiple questionnaire scales. And if this is the case, we should use a scoring method that is, like I said, not influenced, like, for example, this D-item scoring. The aim of this whole approach is to have a fair measurement of non-cognitive constructs, meaningful scores, fair assessment of group differences, and appropriate feedback on the group level. So the idea is to get less biased, non-cognitive measures with meaningful, valid responses. Okay, now I quickly would like to show you four different studies. I won't go too much into detail. I just want to give you a broad overview of what we did and what we found so far. So we looked at two data sets where we looked at personality data. One data set is based on the IPIP questionnaire. The other data set is based on the NEO-FFI. In the first study, we had a student sample of American college students from different cultural backgrounds. In the new FFE study, we used the German norm sample from this questionnaire, the non-clinical norm sample. Then we also looked at the PISA 2012 field test data and the PIA 2012 main study data, where we tested students in PISA and adults in PIA. In all four studies, we concentrated on questionnaire scales that used a five-point rating scale, and we looked at the midpoint and the extreme response style. In the first two studies, we measured the big five personality questionnaires. In the PISA study, we had two scales that actually are a part of those big five sales, so also personality measures. And in the PIAC study, we didn't use personality measures, but different kind of scales, skill use scales. And just to give you an idea how these scales look like and what the difference is, so those are examples of items or statements for the Big Five scales. For example, I try to be friendly towards everyone, I always keep my things tidy and clean, I love being around lots of people. And then you can respond with either I agree, I disagree, or something in between. This is what the items kind of looked like in the first three studies. And in the PIAAC study, we had four different scales. We had the so-called skill use, the use of reading skills, writing, numeracy, and computer skills at work. So questions would look like, in your last job, how often did you usually read letters, write reports, prepare charts, use emails, and then you just replied on a 5-point rating scale, how often? From not very often to very often. The difference here and why I show you these two examples is that when we look at these personality measures, these Big Five scales, we might be, or my idea is that we might be more successful in applying our IRT approach, because those five personality scales were developed in a way that we really have five distinct measures that are different. And in these four scales that we have in the PIAAC background questionnaire, those scales were not developed in a way that they should measure different things. So actually, we can assume that there are some correlations between those scales. So it might not be that easy to fit a four-dimensional model to those four scales, even if we don't have response styles. So in this case, it's not so easy when we compare a four-dimensional to a one-dimensional model to really figure out the response styles. It might be much easier in this personality data than in this PIAAC large-scale assessment data. In the first three studies, we used a more item-based approach. In the PIAAC study, we used a respondent-based approach to look at the response styles. In the IPIP data, we tried to see if we can get unidimensional measures of response style when we exclude single deviant items, items that show to be deviant in the one-dimensional model, where we try to model the response styles. So practically, we try to figure out, are there items that are largely not measuring response styles, and if we exclude them, and all the other items do measure response styles, can we then really find them in our data? In the second two studies, in the new FFI and the PISA study, we went to a different approach. Instead of excluding items from the one-dimensional model, we had the idea, what if some respondents give more or less response styles and others don't, and some respondents only give response styles to a few items, but not to all items, like in this fatigue effect that I showed you a few slides ago. Then there is the opportunity that our items measure both the response style and also the trait we are interested in. So we can have a mixture of valid responses and those invalid response styles. And the bifactor model allows items to load on two factors at the same time, on a specific factor, which would be the construct of interest in our case, and on a general factor, which would be the response style factor. And by doing so, we can see if the bifactor model fits the data, how much variance is explained by each factor. So how much variance is explained by the single factors, and how much variance is explained by the response style or the general factor. And then in the PIAAC study, we again went to a different approach, a more respondent-based approach, where we said, well, maybe we have different groups of respondents. There might be groups who do not show response styles at all. There might be groups who show response styles. There might be groups who just show certain response styles, or a mixture of valid and invalid responses. So we might have different latent classes. The nice thing about the last two studies, the large-scale assessment, is that we had cognitive measurements as well in these studies, so we could correlate the response styles with the cognitive measures and see and do some kind of first validation of the response style measures. I will now just quickly go to the main results that we found in this study. So in the IPIP study, we could find that after excluding only one item from our models, that we were able to find a unidimensional measure for the extreme response style. So we could find an extreme response style in the data. It was not that clear with the midpoint response style. Even after excluding several deviant items, we could not find a better fit of the one-dimensional model. But both response style measures show high IRT-based marginal reliabilities. And just to give you an idea, this is a graphical model test for the item difficulties of this e-item scale. So we just divided the sample into a sample with a high and a sample with a low score on these e-items by splitting the sample at the median. And then we plotted the item parameters from the two groups against each other with the idea that all the points, all these item parameters that you see here that are lying close to or on this 45-degree line are showing that they're measuring the same construct or measuring the construct in a unidimensional way. And items that are far away from this line are supposed to be deviant items, not measuring the same construct. And the idea is if we find those items and we exclude them, then we can get to a unidimensional measure. And here, this red cycled item is the one farthest away from this line. And we excluded this item, and after we excluded this one item, we could find that the one-dimensional model does fit the data better than a five-dimensional model with regard to the E items. And this supports the hypothesis that we probably do have an extreme response style. And just for you to have a comparison to the M items, we did the same with the M items. And here you see it doesn't look as nicely as the first graph. A lot of items are far away. And even after excluding 11 items, we couldn't get a distinct decision for one model. Looking at the AIC model index, we see that the five-dimensional model fits the data better, saying that there is no response. And when we look at the BIC index, we see that the one-dimensional model fits the data relatively better, so there might be a midpoint response style. So here it's kind of undecided. We don't really know, do we really have a midpoint response style or not? Maybe it's a kind of a mixture. So in the second study, when we used this bifactor model where an item can load on a response style and a trait factor, we could find that even when the two response style measures are not purely unidimensional, when we do the same approach like in the first study, we can find a better model fit of the bifactor model when we do have a mixture of response styles and trait loadings. And when we look at, in the second study, the bifactor model fitted the data relatively best. And when we look at the explained variances of the different factors, we can see that when we look at the E items, most variance seems to be explained by the extreme response style factor. When we look at the D items, we see that least variance is explained by assumed response style factor, which means that probably with these D items, we're really more measuring more these trait-related responses that we want to measure with the D items, while with the E items, we might measure an extreme response style to a high extent. And with regard to the M items, we see that it seems like not much variance is explained by this midpoint response style factor, so maybe we don't have to be that concerned about a midpoint response style, but definitely it seems like we have to be concerned about the extreme response style in the data. We did a very similar approach with the PISA data, so I'm not going too much into detail here because I think we don't have that much time. Just to give you a first overview of correlations between response style factors and cognitive domains. In PISA, we had the cognitive domain problem solving and the cognitive domain mathematics that we looked at, and we correlated the response style measures and also the two big five measures based on the D items. Again, the D items are the scores where we assume we don't have response style influence. So the D items are a less biased measure of these two scales. And we see that the ERS and the MRS measure both show negative correlations with our cognitive domains across all countries, while we have positive correlations with the two questionnaire scales based on the D items. The negative correlation are very, very low, so it's almost zero correlation, but it's kind of interesting to see that the response styles or the response styles measures do not really correlate with the cognitive domains, while those measures where we think those really are the two personality scales that we want to measure, they do show some correlation with these cognitive proficiencies. So now the last study, with the PIAC data, where we try to see are there different latent classes showing response styles or different patterns in response styles, we could find that The midpoint response style can be measured unidimensionally. The extreme response style is what we were not able to really find a unidimensional measure for the extreme response style. And we applied a mixture IoT model to both and could see that we can find a different, we can find different classes with regard to the ERS measure. So the idea is, okay, we find a unidimensional measurement of the midpoint responder, so we probably do have midpoint responder in the data. We were not so sure about the extreme responder. Do we have this kind of responder in the data or not? So we looked we tried out two different classes, so we assumed maybe we have two latent classes. When we look at our E items that are supposed to measure the extreme response style, and we could find that when we look at, when we incorporate two classes in our models and we have these four BQ scales that we look at and this one response style scale we look at the one-dimensional model, then we can find a better fit of the one-dimensional model. When we don't incorporate two latent classes, then we don't see a response style. And then when we do the same models separately for those two classes, we find we can see that there seem to be one class where we do have a response style because the one-dimensional model fits the data best. And there in the second class, it seems like we don't have a response style because the four-dimensional model fits the data best. And just to give you a quick overview, and then I'm almost finished, here we are looking at graphs that show the patterns of those two different classes that we just saw with regard to the 5-point Likert scale, so the original Likert scale, and how often they choose one of the response categories of this Likert scale. And here we have the first two scales of the questionnaire, and on the left side we have class 1, which we think is our response style class. On the right side we have class 2, and we can see that respondents from class 1 more often give an extreme response compared to class 2, and we see the same picture when we look at the third and the fourth scale. So it really looks like we have a response style class and we have a class that is probably not showing response styles. And we see some very similar correlations with cognitive domains, like in the other study, with negative correlations of the extreme response style. In this study, positive correlations with the midpoint response style and the D-related scales. Those were the studies where we used real data, and now we are moving to another study. We are using now simulated data because we're interested in other things when we look at response style, and we do this study together with actually a Polish colleague, Artur Pokropek. And here we are interested in how much response style in the data is acceptable without too much bias on the international level of international large-scale assessments. At which level of response styles are the XMNT models even able to take response styles? So how much percent of response styles has to be present until the models can really detect it by using this approach? How successful are the different model approaches with regard to different response styles in the data? Is it easier to detect one kind of response style? What if we have more extreme than midpoint response style in the data? Would we still be able to detect the midpoint response style? What if respondents do show more than one response style at one time, so there is a correlation between response styles? And so there are different questions we are asking ourselves. And so it seems like, and we saw this in our real data studies, response styles are much more complex than we would like them to be, and their measurement and their detection is not always straightforward. So now we want to use simulated data to get more ideas on how successful different approaches can be. And yeah, this is work in progress. And that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.